How we doing? Come on, how we doing? Man, was that some good worship or what? Come on, man, yeah, I'm fired up. First hour is rocking and rolling, but welcome. Welcome to our 10 o'clock service. We're glad that you're here. Can we welcome all of those who are joining us online right now? Can we do that real quick? Come on. And man, from my father's heart to you, dads, happy Father's Day. Can we celebrate all the dads and all those who serve as dads and grandpas? Can we do that real quick? Make sure if you're in the building today, stop by the table. You got a chance to win some ribeye steaks. I'll make all you people online right now want to be here. All right. You got a chance. You get some free some stuff from Texas Roadhouse because that's where men eat. And some of you need to learn how to smell better, so we got a special gift for you for that too, all right? So make sure you grab that on your way out, but seriously, use it, all right? So, just kidding. Man, hey, you're going to need it because on July the 16th, we're going to serve all over Grant County, so you're going to need to shower when we're done, all right? So mark your calendars, July the 16th is serve day. Am I the only one excited about July the 16th? All right, it's going to be a great day. Looking forward to it. We hope to send about 200 people plus across Grant County and the city of Marion these bright red shirts to let them know that we're here to serve them. There's no better way than to share the gospel of Jesus Christ and to serve people who desperately need to know him. So we're going to do that on that day. You'll be signing up next week, so you won't want to miss that. Next week, I start a brand new series called Summer at the River, man. How many people are enjoying summer so far? All right. How many people wish it stayed summer longer? Come on. Then move to Florida. I'm just kidding. All right. So we're glad you're here all year round. But man, it's next week we're going to dive into a new series called Go. And man, I'm excited to bring that to you. And it's going to be a phenomenal month of end of June and July and into August. And then we get to August, 21 days of prayer launching August the 7th. Yeah, come on. Okay, the excitement's getting lower. All right, so lots of exciting things happen at the river, and we're glad that you're a part of them. But man, as Sam said, this week is camp. 120-plus students headed off to NTS tomorrow afternoon, and all the parents said, amen, amen. I said, it's a rest break. But man, we actually are praying that God would open the hearts and the minds of people, our young people. I had the privilege Friday night to spend some time, about 2 hours, with about 30 of them. And man, can I tell you, we have some incredibly sharp students at the River Church. And here's what I told them Friday night, just so you know. They are not the leaders of the church of tomorrow. They're the leaders of the church of today. And so, man, we are honored to have them. And so, students, if you're in here, know that we're praying for you this week, and we're going to lift them up. I believe that God's going to call missionaries. I believe he's going to call pastors. I believe he's going to call Christian business people this week. He's going to raise up a group of revolutionaries, and I'm trusting and believing that 120 of them will come back and change your world, all right? And so we're excited about that. But we are going to finish this series called Going the Second Mile. Pastor Amy hit it out of the park last week, amen? That was good stuff, and excited for that message. If you missed that message or the first message, jump online or the River app, and you can catch up with those. I'm going to finish our time by talking about how do we actually experience more of God. If we're going to be second mile Christians, how do we actually kind of paddle against the natural culture that's coming against us, which tells us to be selfish, tells us to keep the ball, tells it to make it all about me? How do we do that? We're going to go back to the most famous sermon ever preached in the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus preaches, and here's one of the things he says in that, Matthew 5, verse 41. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them how many miles? Two, all right? Very simple. And so it just give you some quick history. The Roman Empire is in power. If a Roman soldier came by and told a Jewish person that I'm tired of carrying my own pack, so pick up my pack and carry it for me, you were required by law to carry it for 1 mile. At the end of the 1 mile, you could set it down, dust yourself off, and say, I completed my duty for the day. Or what Jesus is saying is when you get to the end of the first mile, look at the Roman soldier and say, hey, man, bro, I got you. We're going to go 2 miles. And I believe today that if the church in America is actually going to have the influence that we need to have to change the culture that we're living in, then we got to become second mile Christians. We got to become people that says, you know what? you know what, I'll go ahead and carry your pack another mile. I'm not saying that we agree with everything that they think is right or what is wrong, but what I'm saying is we're willing to serve them, willing to do something for them. We're willing to go the second mile. But how do you actually do that is the question. Obviously, if when I was a youth pastor, we would ask questions like that, and you would get the church answer, Jesus. I mean, yeah, we call that, you got to go deeper. No, it's Jesus. And they're right. You got to have a little bit of Jesus, but I'm here to tell you there's got to be more. Can I tell you, the challenges that we're facing are and experiencing today, Jesus is the answer to them. But can I tell you today that Jesus didn't just come to this earth so that he could die for your sins so that you could experience heaven. That wasn't why. So you could have this one moment in time where you got on your knees and you prayed and said, Jesus, forgive me of all my sins and come into my heart. That's not the only reason why he came, was for you to experience eternal life. He came and died for you, became fully human, so that you could actually experience freedom. We just sing about it, and we jump, and we shout, and we raise our hands, but do we really believe it? Because here's the deal. I see a lot of followers of Christ walking around with a spiritual limp, and I'm here to tell you today, God never designed you to walk with a spiritual limp. He designed you to run and run your race in freedom and chase it down like never before. So I'm telling you today, church, we don't have to walk with a spiritual limp. God wants you to run, and he's right ready today to say, here's how you run. Somebody needs to do that today. I'll just tell you right up front, this message, most of my messages, when I write them, they take me a couple, 2-3 weeks. We build them out, and we prime the pump. We do all kinds of things. This message God gave to me in 45 minutes. And I believe God has a word for somebody today. I'll never forget that Wednesday morning at my office at home, man, and it was just like boom, 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 and God was bringing scriptures, and he was speaking to me, and we were talking, and I wasn't hearing audibly for him, but man, he was pinning this thing. Because I'm not smart enough to write that fast, I'll just be honest with you. Pastor friend of mine told me about a family in their church who really was struggling because his dad was an alcoholic. He'd served in the military, suffered from some PTSD, and had turned to alcoholism, to alcohol for his answers. But his dad had finally given his life to Jesus. And man, they celebrated that. And as the time went on, though, his dad said, there's got to be more. I've got to be able to overcome this addiction that I have to this alcohol. So the wife, they were brand new believers for the most part. They didn't grow up in the church world. They didn't have all the answers. So common sense says, well, if you're struggling with this, then where do you go? You go to the pastor, right? So he went to the pastor of his church and walked in, and he says, man, I gave my life to Jesus, you know, a couple years ago, and man, I'm trying, but man, I just can't overcome this addiction. The pastor sitting on the other side of the desk looked at him. He says, well, sir, I'm sorry to tell you this, but that's just who you are. You're just an alcoholic. The gentleman stood up, and he walked out of that office. He went home, he sat down on his chair, and his wife came in thinking and anticipating that this pastor would have good wisdom for him. Honey, what did he say? He said, this is just the way I am. I just need to learn to accept it. Walked up the stairs, true story. Walked up the stairs into his bedroom where he reached into his gun safe. He pulled out a pistol and he killed himself that day. Can I tell you, the verdict isn't out yet on you. But I can tell you this, God has set you free. You are not what the world says you are. You are who Jesus says you are. I'd like to find that pastor. Well, anyways, we'll just leave that alone, all right? Because it was about to get pretty unchristlike, and maybe he'll listen to this message. I don't know. You never know. But can I tell you, man, that's a lie from the enemy. And somebody in the room, you're hearing the lie today from the enemy that says, this is just who you are. You can't be free. You can't be free. You can't actually be more. You can't actually experience more. I'm here to tell you that you can. I'm here to tell you that he can help you live the abundant life that he's designed for you in spite of the brokenness of the world that we live in. He can help you go the second mile when it doesn't make sense to go the second mile, when it's going to hurt to go the second mile. And so for the next few minutes, I'm going to show you how this works directly from Scripture. How can you actually do that? How can you actually experience more than eternal life? How can you experience freedom while you're on this earth? Can I tell you today, I'm going to share with you about the one who can heal you. I'm going to share with you about the one who can mend your broken heart. I'm going to share with you about the one who can help you overcome the pain of life today. The question is will you walk with him? Luke chapter 4, let's just dive into the Scriptures. He went to Nazareth where he had been brought up, talking about Jesus right here. And on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue as was his custom, a.k.a. Jesus went to church. Amen? This was a custom for him. It's just not a habit. So those of you that are here today, I applaud you. Those of you that are not, shame on you. All right? He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written. Come on, man. It's good stuff. The Spirit of the Lord. The what? The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has what? So the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of God has anointed who? Who are we talking about? Jesus. Understand that. We're talking about Jesus because he needs the anointing of the Father. Why? Because he's taken on the flesh of man. He humbled himself and became human. So he needs the anointing. And he anointed him to do what? To proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim what? Proclaim, what's the word? Freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Can I tell you, grab hold of this. Jesus did everything on this earth through the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus needed the Holy Spirit in order to do what he did while he was on this earth. If Jesus was actually going to set prisoners free and preach good news to the poor and bring freedom and proclaim it, recover the sight for the blind to set these people free, can I tell you, he needed the Holy Spirit. So I'm just here to say, if Jesus needed the Holy Spirit, don't you think you do? So before this day's over, I'm simply going to ask you to pray. Jesus, would you do for us what you did, what God did for you? Somebody today, you need the Holy Spirit because you're trying to do this all in your own power. I'm here to tell you, somebody today, you need this. Because God anointed him, Jesus was able to do everything that he did. So you want to know how to live the second mile of life? Ask God today, give me your Holy Spirit. Pour yourself out upon me so that I can do this, not in my own strength, but in yours. Because you cannot do it naturally. I cannot do it naturally. When we see the word anoint throughout Scripture, in the Greek, it actually means to smear or to rub. In the Hebrew, it actually means to pour. Now, what's interesting to me is, in the American church today, we do what, I mean, Michael Jr. calls it, we like to dab. You know, we anoint people here at the river often, and I kind of, you come up and it's really nice smelling oil, by the way, and it's, you know, maybe it's straight from Israel. I don't know if it is or not, but they tell us if it is, it's probably just olive oil with some perfume in it. All right, moving on. And so they give it to us, and we dab it on you, and we maybe make a cross, and I do the deal. But that's not what it is in Scripture. It actually says to pour. In the Old Testament, people didn't get dabbed. Let's just look at it real quick. Genesis 28:18. It says, early the next morning, Jacob took the stone he had placed under his head. Not a very comfortable pillow, you know what I'm saying? What's that pillow guy that we always talk about? My pillow. He needs a my pillow. All right? There, I can get a free one for that. All right, send that clip to that guy and give me a free my pillow. Anyway, under his head and set it up as a pillar. And he did what? He poured oil on top of it. He anointed it. Exodus 29:7 says, take the anointing oil and anoint him by doing what? Pouring it on his head. 1 Samuel 10:1. Then Samuel took a flask of olive oil and poured it on Saul's head and kissed him, saying, has not the Lord anointed you ruler over his inheritance? It's very clear that they poured it. Why? Because some of us, when you dab it, you think I can dab it here and I can dab it there and I can dab it in all the little parts of my life that I don't want to let the Holy Spirit have. Holy Spirit can have this part. Holy Spirit can have that. You can have that part. And I'll dab it here and a little bit of dab there and a little dab there. And we are dabbing until Jesus comes back. You know what I'm saying? And so we're dab, dab, dab. But the reality is, when you pour something over someone, you can't contain it. I've got this half 16 ounces of water here. Do I have any volunteers? Just kidding. All right, I just don't want to do this, but I tried, and some of the men were like, I don't want to mess my hair up, you know? It's Father's Day. I'm like, sissies. All right. But in the most famous moments of anointing we see in the New Testament, where Jesus was anointed at Bethany, we see where a woman comes and does this for him. It says it's worth a year's wages. Let's just look at it. Matthew 26:7. It says it right here. A woman came to him with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume, which she, what? Poured on his head as he was reclining at the table. So they tell us that a year's worth of this perfume, scholars do, is about 16 ounces. So it's about that much water. And she would have walked up and she would have poured that over Jesus. This wasn't a cheap deal. This was costly to her. And guess what? It couldn't be contained. When you dab, you can control. When you pour, it goes wherever it's going to go. And somebody today, you need to stop dabbing in the Holy Spirit, and you need to ask the Holy Spirit to pour. You're going to say, pour yourself over me and let me experience you. Acts chapter 10 says, you know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John preached. We're talking about John the Baptist right here. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth. You see it right here? You know, a little dove comes out of the sky. It's this cool moment. With the Holy Spirit and power. And how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil. Because God was what? Because God was with him. We talk often that we're going to go to the gates of hell. And we're going to take back what the enemy stole from us. We're going to take back territory in our culture. Can I tell you, the church is not going to win this battle if we try to do it on our own power. Church, you got to wake up and hear me today. You cannot overcome the enemy on your own power. If you're going to be victorious, we need the anointing of the Holy Spirit. You need to ask Jesus to do for you what he already did and experienced himself. Luke 24:49. He says it this way, I'm going to send you what my Father has promised. He's told you he'll do it for you, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. When you see the word clothed, it means in the Greek to put on something, to sink in. What is the purpose of clothing? It's to cover things up. Praise God for that today. Amen? Can I get an amen on that at least today? You may not like the message, but you're glad your neighbor's got clothes on, right? Hello? Come on. Protects you. Man, every time we go to a warmer climate, you know, that's not Indiana where the sun shines more than a couple months out of the year. When we go to Florida, wherever, you know, it's everybody kind of jokes and laughs because I always go buy like long sleeve shirts to wear because I'm petrified of getting sunburned. All right. Like just not, it doesn't feel good. It's like, it's a little bit like, I've always questioned people who drink alcohol. Like, you get drunk, and then you feel horrible the next morning. Like, was it really worth it? You spend a lot of money to feel like junk. And I'm like, I spent a lot of money for vacation to feel sunburned. And you know where that came from? Because on our honeymoon, I got sun poisoning. So that's a whole other story, all right? And so I got burnt, baby. I was, oof, don't touch me, all right? You sleep in that bed. I was like, hey, moving on. It's a whole other story. It's a different message. But can I tell you today, when you put on the Holy Spirit, it protects you. Somebody today, you need to be protected, and you can't do it on your own. Jesus has done and did all that he did and done by the power of the Holy Spirit. There's no wonder that the devil does everything he can to bring division around the Holy Spirit. Some of you need to throw out your old doctrine. You need to throw out your old theology because some of you've bought into a lie. Like it's this scary thing. And some of you have gone the other direction and think it's for fun. But the Holy Spirit designed the spiritual gifts for function. And so I'm here to tell you today, friends, like the enemy has made us buy a bunch of lies because he knows that's the one power source we have against him. Even at the mention of his name. the mention of his name. Satan knows that if we become second-mile Christians, that the world is going to be changed, that we can actually change our culture by the power of the Holy Spirit living in us and through us. Satan is not afraid of you on your own, though. He's not afraid of you. He laughs at you. Oh, but man, when he realizes you've got the power of the Holy Spirit breathing inside of you, oh, he will petrify before you. When we look to the Gospels, there's really four main events that we see mentioned in all four of them. I mean, some of Matthew will talk about some things and you won't see it in others, but there's four main things that we always see in all four Gospels. It's the birth, the death, the resurrection, and the baptism of the Holy Spirit in Jesus. So I think it's a big deal. Let's just look at it real quick. Matthew 3:11. This is John the Baptist. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he who is coming after me, he's talking about Jesus, is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. It's just a lot like what LeBron James would say, you know, about Michael Jordan. Anyways, moving on. But he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and what? Fire. Let's go to the book of Mark. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the what? Holy Spirit. Luke 3, John answered them all, I baptize you with water. Are you catching on to this drift yet? But the one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. I mean, now we're understanding LeBron is saying he can't even touch Jordan's like shoestrings, all right? Saying I'm not worthy to tie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. And then in the Gospel of John, it says, and I myself did not know him. But the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come down, and this is the dove, you know the story, and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. In every one of these passages, you see the word baptize. Whenever you see that in the Greek, it's the word baptizo, which actually means to submerge, to dip, or to make one fully wet. In the Old Testament, it's referring to the process that where they would take a shirt. This was like the original tie-dye event in the Old Testament, all right? And they would take a cloth and they would dip it into some dye. And when they would pull it out, it would be the color that was just dipped into. Somebody today, you need to be dipped in and submerged into the Holy Spirit so that you can come out looking like him. Clearest example that shows the meaning of baptizo in the text from the Greek, I think, now you're going to think, he's really smart on this one, is by a Greek poet and physician named Nicander. Around 200 BC, it's actually a recipe this old for making pickles. So those of you that have a garden, you should listen closely, all right? Nicander says that in order to make a pickle, the vegetable should first be dipped or baptized into boiling water. So if you catching me, take notes. And then, taken out of the boiling water and then baptized or baptizoed in the original text into a vinegar solution. Both verbs, here's what he writes, both verbs concern the immersing of vegetables in a solution. The first is temporary. Water is temporary. But the second, the act of baptizing the vegetable in the vinegar solution produces a permanent change upon the vegetable. You're like this is the original, like VeggieTales moment. All right, if you've been around the church, like this is it. Nicander had it before everybody else. But today, can I tell you, somebody needs to be baptized, not just because in water, which just gives you you need to be baptized by the Holy Spirit, which brings a permanent change to you. Amen. He makes you different. Gang, as we finish up this morning, I want to challenge all of us, no matter where we've come from, or what our journeys have been. I know this, to be a second mile Christian, I need the power of God and I need the power of his Spirit in me. In Acts 2, we see this amazing moment that we call the day of Pentecost, and when the Holy Spirit falls, and there's some really cool things that happen that day. And then when we jump ahead to Acts chapter 4, I mean, the Apostle Peter, who literally denies Christ three times, has now just preached this amazing message, and then he gets thrown in prison, and we pick it up in Acts chapter 4, verse 31, as they've just been released, and here's what it says. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God, how? Boldly. Can I just ask you today, right now? Right there in your seat, you know who you are. Does somebody need to be filled with the Holy Spirit today? Don't raise your hand. Just you know who you are right now. You need a fresh anointing. Because you know who you are, because you're trying to live your life on your own. You're trying to overcome the evil of this world on your own. You're trying to overcome whatever it is that's got you oppressed, whatever it is that has you limping along on your own power. If that's you, I'm here to tell you that you need the Holy Spirit to pour over you, to be baptized in it. Psalm 92:10 says this. It says, you have exalted my horn, the horn of my soul, like that of a wild ox. Fine oils have been poured on me. In the King James Version, it actually says that he was anointed with fresh oil. Somebody, maybe you've experienced the Holy Spirit before. Maybe you've been empowered by the Spirit of God before, but you need fresh oil today. You need a fresh anointing. I don't know about you, but when people, I've been privileged a few times to be around people in their final days. Man, there's just something that happens in those moments. You know what I'm talking about? If you've ever been there, and every word that's spoken, like you want to grab hold of it, and you're leaning in because, man, it's like these are the final words that this person could say to you. Anybody ever been there? And you're leaning in and you're listening. Because you want to make sure you grab it all. What I want you to do is I want you to close your eyes for a second. I'm not going to do anything freaky, all right? And I want you to lean in. And I want to share with you the words of Jesus. These are the final words of Jesus when he says, I will talk to the Father. And he'll provide you another friend. That's what he's saying to you today. So that you will always have someone with you. This friend is the Spirit of Truth. The friend, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send at my request, well, he'll make everything plain to you. He will remind you of all the things I have told you. I am leaving you well and whole. That's my parting gift to you, peace. So let me say it again, this truth. It's better for you that I leave. If I don't leave, the friend won't come. But if I go, I'll send him to you. But when the friend comes, the Spirit of the Truth, he will take you by the hand. These are the words of Jesus to you today. And he will guide you into all the truth that there is. And in Acts, he says, after his death, he presented himself alive to them in many different settings over a period of 40 days. In face-to-face meetings, he talked to them about things concerning the kingdom of God. As they met and ate meals together, he tells them this, that they were on no account to leave Jerusalem, but must wait for what the Father had promised. The promise you heard from me, John baptized in water, and you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit, and soon. What you'll get is the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you will be able to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and all over Judea and Samaria, and even to the ends of the world. Give me your eyes. These were his last words. Lean into them. These were his last words. So today, it's very simple for me to you, whether you're online or you're in this room. You know who you are, that you're trying to live this life on your own power. Can I tell you today, don't leave until you're anointed with the Holy Spirit. Somebody in the room today, you need to ask God, you need to ask Jesus to do for you what was done for him. You need to ask him to send his friend to you. The same friend that was sent to Jesus needs to be sent to you. Pray right now, right there in your seat, ask God to submerge you, to dip you. Ask God to baptize you in his Holy Spirit. Folks, don't give the verdict on this life before God is done. Don't give up before you experience the fullness of the glory of God that will come through his Spirit. With every head bowed, every eye closed, you're here today, you're joining online, and God has spoken to you, and you today know that that's you, and you need a fresh anointing. I'm gonna pray for you. We're gonna worship for a second or two and allow you some time to ask for that. But if that's you today, I just want you to slip your hand up right here. You're like, Matthew, I need to be baptized by the Spirit today. Yeah, anybody else, just keep them up. Yeah, keep them up for me all over the place. Yeah, anybody else, just ask him right now. Just say, God, I need this today. I need you to do for me what you did for your son. I need you to fill me today with your Spirit today. I'm asking you today to do that. Father, you've seen every hand that's raised. God, I pray that right now that they begin to ask, God, and God, that you would do whatever you want to do, that God, you would do whatever you can do, whatever your power leads to do. God, I pray that you would manifest yourself in new and fresh ways as your power infiltrates us, as we're baptized by your power today. That those that are broken will be made whole. Those that are limping would be healed.
Yes, yes.
Those that are in bondage and oppressed would be free.
Yes.
So as we worship in these closing moments, there's probably 30 or 40 of you that raised your hand. Across to my left, across to my right. There's communion all throughout. You just need to ask, Holy Spirit, show up and baptize me. You know what areas of your life you need to just say it to him and give it to him and put it on the cross, write it down, put it on the cross and just celebrate and allow him to flow over you as we worship now. Stand with me. As God spoke to you, you move to those places. Let's worship together.